During the closure of our church due to the pandemic, we reverted many months ago to these virtual services. Now that we have begun a slow reopening, we plan to continue providing you the enjoyment of our weekly virtual pre-recorded service, and we'll be incorporating segments of our live services for your worship enjoyment. The Congregation of Faith Lutheran Church hope that at some point in the near future, you have an opportunity to visit us and worship with us each Sunday at 10 a.m., followed by a safe and friendly fellowship experience afterwards.
Precious Lord, take my hand, lead me on, help me stand. I am tired, I am weak, I am worn. Through the storm, through the night, lead me on to the light, and take my hand, precious Lord, lead me home. When my way grows drear, precious Lord, linger near. When my life is almost gone, hear my cry, hear my call, hold my hand, lest I fall, and take my hand, precious Lord, lead me home. When the darkness appears and the night draws near and the day is past and gone, and take my hand, precious Lord, lead me home. Precious Lord, take my hand, lead me on, help me stand. For I am tired, I am weak, I am worn. Take my hand, precious Lord, lead me home.
Good morning. The first lesson today is from Isaiah chapter 56, verse 1 and 6 through 8. This is what the Lord says, be just and fair to all. Do what is right and good, for I am coming soon to rescue you and to display my righteousness among you. I will also bless the foreigners who commit themselves to the Lord, who serve him and love his name, who worship him and do not desecrate the Sabbath day of rest, and who hold fast to my covenant. I will bring them to my holy mountain of Jerusalem and will fill them with joy in my house of prayer. I will accept their burnt offerings and sacrifices, because my temple will be called a house of prayer for all nations. The sovereign Lord, who brings back the outcasts of Israel, says, I will bring others too, besides my people Israel. The word of God, the word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Psalm 67. May God be merciful and bless us. May his face smile with favor on us. May your ways be known throughout the earth, your saving power among people everywhere. May the nations praise you, O God. Yes, may all the nations praise you. Let the whole world sing for joy, because you govern the nations with justice and guide the people of the whole world. May the nations praise you, O God. Yes, may all the nations praise you. Then the earth will yield its harvest, and God, our God, will richly bless us. Yes, God will bless us, and people all over the world will fear him. The second lesson today is from Romans chapter 11, verse 1 through 2, 13 through 15, and 28 through 32. I ask then, has God rejected his own people, the nation of Israel? Of course not. I myself am Israelite, a descendant of Abraham and a member of the tribe of Benjamin. No, God has not rejected his own people, whom he chose from the very beginning. Do you realize what the scriptures say about this? Elijah the prophet complained to God about the people of Israel and said, I am saying all this especially for you Gentiles. God has appointed me as the apostle to the Gentiles. I stress this, for what I want somehow to make the people of Israel jealous of what the Gentiles have, so I might save them. For since their rejection meant that God offered salvation to the rest of the world, their acceptance will be even more wonderful. It will be life for those who were dead. Many of the people of Israel are now enemies of the good news, and then this benefits you Gentiles. Yet they are still the people he loves because he chose their ancestors, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. For God's gift and his call can never be withdrawn. Once you Gentiles were rebels against God, but when the people of Israel rebelled against him, God was merciful to you instead. Now they are the rebels, and God's mercy has come to you so that they, too, will share in God's mercy. For God has imprisoned everyone in disobedience so he can have mercy on everyone. The word of God, the word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Reading from the Holy Gospel, Matthew 15, verses 21 through 28. Glory to you, O Lord. Then Jesus left Galilee, went north to the region of Tyre and Sidon. A Gentile woman who lived there came to him, pleading, Have mercy on me, O Lord, son of David, for my daughter is possessed by a demon that torments her severely. But Jesus gave her no reply, not even a word. Then his disciples urged him to send her away. Tell her to go away, they said. She is bothering us with all her begging. Then Jesus said to the woman, I was sent only to help God's lost sheep, the people of Israel. But she came and worshiped him, pleading again, Lord, help me. Jesus responded, It isn't right to take the food from the children and throw it to the dogs. She replied, That's true, Lord. But even dogs are allowed to eat the scraps that fall beneath their master's table. Dear woman, Jesus said to her, Your faith is great, your request is granted, and her daughter was instantly healed. The Gospel of the Lord.
I know that my Redeemer lives. What comfort this sentence gives. He lives, he lives who once was dead. He lives, my enemy. tears. He lives to calm my troubled heart. He lives all blessings to impart.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
What marks a life as being good, pleasant, unified with others? Tyre and Sidon are two trade posts that were north of Israel at the time of Jesus, and actually were part of Canaan when Israel was given over to the tribes. The area of Asher was, the tribe of Asher was the one that lived in the area of Sidon and Tyre, right along the Mediterranean coast. We'll talk about those a little bit later on. We want to look first at our Isaiah reading, Isaiah 56. I'm going to use verses 7 and 8. It says here, I will accept their burnt offerings and sacrifices because my temple will be called a house of prayer for all nations. Accept whose burnt offerings and sacrifices? What are all nations? Well, this is saying that not only is God going to accept the Jews, but he's going to accept everybody of every color and race and from every nation. And he's going to accept them if they come to him and want to be part of his kingdom. Verse 8 says, for the sovereign Lord who brings back the outcasts of Israel says, I will bring others too besides my people Israel. One of the things that we learn about Tyre is that it was a very big port, a very important port. In fact, if we were to look at it today, you would realize from the readings that you read about it that the port is actually 4,750 years old, one of the oldest places there is. And it was a port where they had all kinds of commerce going on, whether by ship or by land. But it wasn't easy to get to Tyre. Behind Tyre, behind the Mediterranean and parallel with the Mediterranean Sea, were the mountains of Lebanese, the Lebanese mountains. They were jagged rocks, very tough to get through. There weren't roads going through there. In fact, you had to go down and around the mountains and go along parallel to the sea in order to get to Tyre or Sidon. And so it was a very self-fortified place. You had to reach it by sea or by a very narrow strip of land which could be very well fortified and protected. Let me move on now to our Psalm 67. It says this, may the nations praise you, O God. Yes, may all the nations praise you. Again, talking about all the nations being proselytized to Israel. Now that's a big word, proselytized. What does that mean? Well, you know what it really means? It really means essentially about the same thing as evangelized means. Evangelism is the putting forth of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Okay? After the time of Jesus Christ. Proselytizing is teaching people about the Jewish faith and what is to come, which includes the Messiah, okay? And it talks about it proselytizing as being telling people about the coming of a better time, a better world, and that it would be done through the Messiah. That's what proselytizing is done before Christ and evangelizing after Christ. That's my interpretation. That's the way I see it. Let us go on to our Romans 11 reading. Romans 11:31. Now they, the Israelites, are the rebels, and God's mercy has come to you, the Gentiles, so that they, the Israelites, too, will share in God's mercy. You see, God couldn't get across to the Jews during Jesus' time the mercy that he had for them. And Jesus, in many times, warns them and threatens them about that. And he just couldn't get across to them. And so God is saying, I'm going to show the mercy to the Gentiles, and the Gentiles will be the example to the Jewish people who didn't believe, who will come to believe because of the Gentiles and see the difference in why the Gentiles believed and the Jews didn't. Moving on to verse 32, for God has imprisoned everyone, every one of us, Jews and Gentiles, every person from every nation, in disobedience. He could have mercy on everyone because disobedience is unbelief. And so he can have mercy on everyone because they have something wrong with them. It's hard to have mercy on somebody that doesn't have anything wrong with them. But the one thing that we all have wrong with us is unbelief at some time in our life. Man, when lost, has been his own worst enemy by having refused the offers of mercy. The theologian Albert Lee said this, "Here, Lord, I yield myself to thee. 'Tis all that I can do." That's all we can do, is we can yield ourselves to the ever-present God in our life who's trying to show us the way to, through Jesus Christ, to him. I want to move on to an Ezekiel reading, 26:3. As the sea caused his waves, this is just one short reading of that. And he's talking about Tyre. Tyre suffered from successive waves of invasion, starting with Nebuchadnezzar around 500 BC. Nebuchadnezzar pounded Tyre for 13 years trying to conquer Tyre and never did it. And then along came Alexander the Great about 200 years later. And Alexander the Great did the same thing, but he did succeed, and he did it in 15 months. But we need to put in there the caveat that Tyre had never fully recovered from the pounding that Nebuchadnezzar made over 200 years earlier. There were other waves of people who tried to conquer Tyre and used it. The Crusaders used it, and the Saracens used it. It was not finally overthrown entirely until the 13th century, yet it never recovered from the blow which the king of Babylon inflicted upon them, Nebuchadnezzar. Moving on, I want to introduce you to a word that includes our reading of Tyre and Sidon. It's from Matthew 11:21. It says, "Woe unto you, Chorazin! Woe unto you, Bethsaida! For if the mighty works that have been done in Tyre and Sidon, which were done in you, you would have repented long ago in sackcloth and ashes." Now what does that mean, sackcloth and ashes? Well, number one, sackcloth and ashes means you would want to punish yourself so much you'd put yourself in. I don't know if many of you have ever felt sackcloth, but sackcloth is very scratchy and very irritating, and it will make your skin welt up in hives and everything. And ashes does the same thing. So when you combine the two of them and rub them on your skin and put them on your skin and wear them for a couple days, it makes you very susceptible to being very irritated. And you would rather do that than to do the things that Chorazin and Bethsaida, who saw the miracles that Jesus performed. Let me put that in a little simpler terms. The word woe, W-O-E, sometimes in Old English spelled just W-O. But the word W-O-E is one of the very prevalent words in the Old and New Testaments, and you find it often. And what it literally means is it means this, you would rather wish that you were dead than to go through the punishment you're going to go through for not doing what was told to you by Jesus but whatever the consequence might be for you for whatever's told you in the Old Testament. In other words, woe to you, Chorazin. Woe to you, Bethsaida. For the mighty works which were done in Tyre and Sidon have been done in you. You would have repented long ago in sackcloth and ashes. Sackcloth and ashes being the way in which people punish themselves because they're both very itchy. Let me move on now to our epistle for today. And guess what? It also includes Tyre and Sidon. Let's begin right at the beginning. Matthew 15:21. Then Jesus left Galilee and went north to the region of Tyre and Sidon. Again, I explained where they were. North up on the Mediterranean. North, the most northern part of what was the old Israel, and was the northern part of Canaan. So the Gentile woman we're actually talking about here was really a Canaanite woman, or even known as Syrophoenician woman. Let me go to the next verse. A Gentile woman who lived there came to him, meaning Jesus, pleading, "Have mercy on me, O Lord, Son of David, for my daughter is possessed by a demon that torments her severely." Now this woman had to have been very good at arguing because she did some very special things in this opening sentence to me. Have mercy on me. She's acknowledging that she knows that Jesus can have mercy on her. O Lord is recognizing Jesus for his power, because that's what she's saying to him. You, the powerful one. Son of David is recognizing him for who he is. The Son of David is often used in the Old Testament and even in the New Testament as being the words used to describe the person who comes in the form of the Messiah. So she's saying, you are all powerful, you are merciful, you are the Messiah. And I would like you to heal my daughter because she is tormented by a demon. The next verse, 23. But Jesus gave her no reply, not even a word. Then his disciples urged him to send her away. Tell her to go away, they said. She is bothering us with all her begging. The woman was very persistent. There's another story in the New Testament that talks about a very persistent woman bothering a judge until the judge releases her of her guilt and her fine. Well, this woman was also being very persistent, but a little different because this woman wasn't even Jewish. But she knew things about the Jewish religion. Then Jesus said to the woman, this is verse 24, then Jesus said to the woman, I was sent only to help God's lost sheep, the people of Israel. Verse 25, but she came and worshiped him, pleading, Lord, help me. Jesus told her, I only came for the lost sheep, the people of Israel. And yet this woman probably was proselytized and taught about the religion of the Jews. And all of a sudden now she becomes very knowledgeable and she's talking with him, begging and pleading, almost to the point where begging and pleading is really an argument. But she came and worshiped him, pleading, Lord, help me. I told you last week, what is the world's shortest prayer? Help. What did she say to the Lord? Lord, help. Jesus responded, it isn't right to take food from the children and throw it to the dogs. Now he may have said this to catch the ear and please the ear of his disciples because they were there with him. This is a saying that would often be said in the area of Israel, when people would come along from other areas and other nations, if they weren't Jewish, they were often referred to and called dogs. Even women were called dogs. And it isn't right to take food from the children and throw it to the dogs. And she replied, that's true, Lord. Again, she assigns them that word of power, Lord. That's true, Lord, but even dogs are allowed to eat the scraps that fall beneath their master's table. Now she's added a new word in there, master. She's acknowledging that he is her master. She is acknowledging that he is her Lord. And this is what Jesus said. Dear woman, Jesus said to her, your faith is great. Your request is granted. And her daughter was instantly healed. What could we do to create better unity with our family or community? What activities could we have? Jesus often involved food with his ministry. What can we do? In the name of unity, what can we do to bring people together? Not only for God's purpose, but for the purpose of this world right now, under the influence of God. This woman came to Jesus as part of the world, but she left as part of his flock, becoming a full believer not only in the God that she already believed in, but in Jesus Christ as being the Messiah. One thing that God is and always has been with us is he's inclusive. I think that's one of the main things we have to do, is we have to be inclusive. If you know somebody who's seeing this and you want others to see this, call them and tell them. This is a good program. We have a good church service. We have good people in this church, and we love the people from the outside. We want them to be part of us, and we want to be able to help them. And so we ask for a special blessing upon this church, not only for what we're doing, but for what we're capable of doing for those you know who do not yet know Jesus Christ. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
May you be wrapped up in God's love and kept safe and cherished. May the healing power of Christ breathe across your being. Amen.